What do you think about the Laker team now?
You follow the box scores of the games every day?
Just the Lakers.
You're kidding. That is really a compliment.
I was pleased to see you smile at the top of our show, because once the game starts, you have a game face. You don't smile much out there.
I don't think you have to do things for money anymore.
Correct.
What's up, Laker fans? Welcome to Laker Film Room Podcast. I'm Pete, joined as always by Darius. Today we have a very special guest. She's someone, both her and her son, that Laker fans have really embraced in a way that that has been really cool to see. And it is the one and only Karri Kuzma. Karri, thank you so much for joining us.
No problem.
So I was at the game last night and Kyle was going nuts. And I started thinking about you and thinking, you know, we were going to talk today. And, you know, just 7 or 8 months ago, Kyle was working out for teams, kind of wondering where he'd be drafted, where he'd be spending the next few years of his life. And I was thinking, you know, how wild has all of this been for you, Karri?
Pretty surreal, actually. I don't know. Sometimes I just feel like it's a dream.
Yeah, I bet. I mean, yeah, how much has your life changed? Like, what's different in your life now than it was, you know, a few months back?
You know, I don't think it's so much change for me than it has for Kyle, just because he's becoming, you know, so popular and a star. And, you know, I live in Michigan, so it's not like, you know, he's visible with me all the time, so not everybody knows, you know, who I am. But, I mean, just life has changed rather than anything else, you know, just watching more games throughout the week, just stuff like that, you know, being more tired. Games are so late. So just that, and just maybe, you know, not struggling as much. That's pretty much it.
Yeah, so you're over there on East Coast time. This is something that us Lakers fans sort of we hear from fans a lot about, you know, oh, they've got such a big following all across the country and even across the world. So I think it's sort of funny and interesting to hear like a parent talk about, you know, staying up late to maybe watch games the same way that fans do. So it's like appointment viewing for you.
Yeah. And, you know, I mean, I'm pretty much used to it because he went to Utah. So, you know, that's pretty much that's a 2-hour difference. But the difference is, you know, in college, he might have had 1-2 games a week. And now it's like games back to back or every other day. So, I mean, that's the biggest change. So I know that if I'm tired, I know he's really tired.
Yeah, I can only imagine. That's right. That's right. Especially
I can't complain, though.
Luke playing him some of those 40-minute nights. Yes.
Yeah, I'm not getting beat up like him.
I was going to ask, so the fact that he did go to college in Utah and now he's playing his pro career on the West Coast, did you ever have this want for him to play closer to home? Not necessarily in college, but now that he's been drafted to the pros, would it have been nice for him to play for the Pistons or for the Bulls or the Bucks or something like that?
Yeah, of course. It would have been nice. But I think in his mind, he already knew he really wanted to play on the West Side, and that's where he realistically wanted to go. So I'm glad he got to go there. And honestly, I just told him, as long as there's palm trees wherever you're going, I don't care.
That's right.
That's a good attitude to have for sure. How has all of this been for him? You kind of touched on it a little bit of it being surreal, but how is he handling all of this, you know, becoming a star, really?
Honestly, I think he's handling it pretty well. I think that it was always in him, so he's adjusting pretty easily.
Yeah, I'm around him on a fairly regular basis, and I, you know, I coach a little bit of high school basketball, and I know kind of how young men can be, and almost all of them act like they're confident, but very few of them are.
Uh-huh.
Kyle is one of the few like young men that he is legitimately to the core confident and very comfortable in his own skin. Is that something he's always been like? Has he been like that since a little kid, or where do you think he gets that from?
Yeah, he's pretty much always been like that. And since he's been little. I probably gets it from me because I honestly feel like there's nothing. I mean, there probably are some things I can't do. But in my mind, I always approach things like there's nothing I can't do. Even if it's, you know, starting a new job or learning something, I think you always have to have that attitude. You can't be afraid of things, you know, going into them.
No, definitely. So an interesting thing to me, thinking about some of the things I've read about Kyle when he was young, is that he was the kid who was telling his teachers and telling people in his life that he was going to make it to the NBA, that was his dream. Mm-hmm. And as a parent, I'm wondering how you go about, and, you know, I'm a parent myself. I'm sure there are going to be parents who are listening to this podcast as well. Just sort of, how do you foster something like that, that is so big, right? It almost seems unreachable, but yet here he is now. And he's in the NBA and he's making a name for himself on, you know, historically one of the marquee franchises. And so I'm wondering, there's that saying, right, about how it takes a village, but you're on the front lines of that. So I'm wondering, like, how do you foster that in him? What did you see in him when he was young that you're helping him step by step to get to the place where he is now?
I think he's always been special. I mean, when he was in the eighth grade, he had a plan, an ABC plan. So his plan A was being in the NBA, and if that didn't work out, plan B was to play overseas, and then plan C was to be a sports commentator. And when your kid tells you he wants to do something, of course you want to, you know, stand behind them and say, you can do that. You can be whatever you want to be.
Yeah.
And, you know, he started playing basketball probably in the second grade and, you know, for the most part played almost every summer. Maybe there was a couple of summers that he didn't play. But he always had a plan in his mind of what he wanted to do. And I mean, up until probably like even playing in the eighth grade, you know, he'd say, you know, I want to be in the NBA. And while I would watch him play and I'd be like, well, you know, he's not great. He might not even be good right now. You know what I'm saying? I'm going to tell him he's not good because I'm going to tell him he can do it. And the fact of the matter is, yeah, he might not have been great right then, but in my mind and in my heart, like, I always knew, like, what his potential could be. And that's what I saw.
So along those lines, that's a great answer, by the way. Along those lines, you know, he was considered a three-star prospect in high school. He was considered like a mid, you know, you guys didn't know where he'd be picked in the draft. But he has this, you know, and here we are, right? He's top 10 in large part to you, you know, in front court voting for the NBA All-Star game as a rookie. He's really, you know, taken the league by storm. You kind of alluded to this by saying, you know, when I watched him in eighth grade, he was good, but maybe not great. You know, he was not one of those guys where the hardcore basketball fans hear his name when he's in eighth or ninth grade, which is true of a lot of the top picks. And I mean, he just busted up Jason Tatum last night. And Jason Tatum was a kid that I knew of when he was eighth, ninth grade, you know? And when it's not a sure thing, right? When you don't have colleges coming up to you when he's in middle school and shoe companies trying to get him to the, you know, elite 24 camps, things like that. How do you kind of keep him on track as a parent, and how did he stay on track to not like lose hope for his dream?
Well, I mean, I think he's just always been a hard worker, and he, you know, he was always wanting to be outside, you know. And kids were different back then than they are now. And now they just want to be in the house and on video games. But he was always outside, always playing basketball. You know, he was always on an AAU team, played in school. So just keeping him really focused on playing and knowing what he wanted to do. And, I mean, just followed through, you know.
I wanted to ask you, I read a little bit that you had an athletic background yourself, that when you went to college that you were actually on a track scholarship, and that you were a shot put champion when you were in high school. That's true, right?
Yeah, I played all sports pretty much all through high school, and then I did get a track scholarship.
So were you sort of the influence on Kyle in terms of like moving him towards sports, or was it something that he sort of gravitated to naturally? You said that he was like, I've read stories about him with his like little Tykes hoop up in the living room and shooting baskets in front of the house when he was younger. Was that stuff that sort of he took naturally to, or were you sort of an influence on that when he was young?
Well, I definitely think that I was, you know, I was probably an influence because I wanted, he was a boy, number one, and I wanted him to play sports, you know, because I was very athletic. And then even in my family, there's lots of athletes. So yeah, I was the one that, you know, wanted to buy him the hoop and just wanted to get him started and hopefully have him find something that he liked. I wanted all my kids to play sports, but he's the only one that actually wanted to play sports. So, yeah, I probably did push him a little bit, but luckily he turned out to love it.
I think that's reflected in his personality too, though, right? Where he's, you know, he is a guy that he really fights for all of this. And I think that that's why Laker fans have really embraced him, is that, you know, there's the old kind of saying that that guy's got a lot of dog in him. You know, your son has a ton of that. And I think that people really pick up on that. Is that something that he kind of gets from you, kind of that tenacity?
Yeah, I mean, I've never been a quitter, and I, you know, never expected him to be to quit anything that he started. I mean, you got to fight through adversity in life. You can't let things get you down. So you just got to keep going.
Yeah. Building on that a little bit, you know, coming from Flint, and we've all read about, you know, the water crisis. And then also not only that, but just sort of some of the conditions that exist there. There's an approach that I've heard a lot of athletes take, which is sort of this idea that I would never sort of change my path to get where I've gotten, that they're sort of a product of their environment, and that has helped drive them and motivate them to get to the places that they are. And I've heard Kyle sort of speak of that too, from the perspective of him as a player. I'm wondering, as a parent, do you sort of take on that same mindset? Were there things that you worked through that you wish that you could have changed, but then now you see where everything is now? And like, how do you evaluate that from a parent's perspective versus your son who was living that and then getting to where he is now as the professional athlete now?
I mean, are you talking just like living in Flint in general, or are you talking about just in life?
Yeah, I think all, like, both of that, really. Uh-huh. You know, Flint itself, and then also just sort of getting to where he is now, sort of that path that he traveled and you along with him as well.
I don't think that there's probably, you know, anything that I would change. I think that everything in life happens for a reason. And so whatever path you're on is probably meant to be. And some are easier than others. But, I mean, just him growing up in this area, I think that it probably just made him a stronger person, you know. He's just seen probably a lot more things that some people in other areas, you know, don't see or don't know. I mean, pretty much the same for me. I don't know. I grew up right outside of Flint, so it was a smaller town. So, I mean, there's not really anything that I would change. I think it just makes you who you are.
Now, one of the kind of stops along the way on that path was between his junior and senior year. He left to go to Rise Academy to join a Vince Sparacio, and that's in Philadelphia. Yeah. I can't imagine, you know, as a parent, being in that position of, you know, this is what your son wants, but it's so far away and it's really... I would imagine, a life-changing experience that is, you know, him working toward his goal, but it's kind of bittersweet. What was that whole, what was that period of time like for you where your son's so far away?
Well, nothing's changed.
That's true, right? He's still far away, right? A little older and maybe a little more able to handle it.
No. I mean, he you know, he told me, you know, when he was a freshman, you know, I want to go away to a prep school. And, you know, I heard him, but I was just like, okay, you know, next subject. And then, you know, he was working with some of his AAU coaches and they were helping him look and stuff. So, I mean, I didn't have to do very much. He, you know, came up to me and said, you know, Mom, I'm not going to go back to, you know, for my senior year, I'm going to go to this prep school I found. And so, you know, and that's just shows the type of person he is, because he, in 11th grade, he did that. He got that going himself. You know, I didn't do it. He did it because that's what he wanted. So, you know, he got ready to go. And yeah, it was hard because he might have been, you know, 16, 17, but, you know, he's still a kid. And so so he, you know, he left. And I mean, it's pretty much been the same. I mean, he comes home for a little while during the summer every year, but that's pretty much it. So, I mean, that was his choice. And it was, I mean, it was hard for me, but at the same time, like, I knew what he wanted and I knew what his goals were.
Yeah.
And so if you believe in your kid or, you know, whatever, then I guess you just have to support it. And that's what I did. So,
yeah, that seems like a real common theme with him, is the self-motivation combined with hard work and real perseverance to sort of get where he's at. And I think that that's just, you know, a testament to him, but also a testament to you and, well, and your guys' family to sort of build that trust and that steadiness to sort of reach those goals. That's just, it's just inspiring to me too. I've got a 6 and a 4-year-old, and so they're in these formative stages themselves, right? Of, you know, just finding the world and figuring things out, and they have these big ideas, and then to have this conversation with you and read more about your guys' background and your story, it's just super inspiring. It really is.
One thing I wanted to ask Karri, he's a really introspective guy. He's very thoughtful, especially for his age. He got a sociology degree, you know, from Utah, and he seems to kind of care about the issues of the world a little more than most NBA players, and especially young guys, uh-huh, tend to. Where does he get that from? Has he always kind of been kind of curious about the world around him and politics and things of that respect? Can you talk a little bit about just kind of where he gets that from?
Well, I think maybe he gets it just because, you know, with him leaving his senior year, I think he had to grow up a little bit faster than most, probably.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So he, you know, got to experience, like, you know, what it's like to be on your own and have to, you know, depend on yourself. But, you know, because, you know, we moved around a lot, he was always a social butterfly. Like, he has friends everywhere. So him being outgoing, I think, allowed him to talk to a lot of different people. And he, you know, it's easy for him to go to people and talk to them. So I think he gained a lot more knowledge because of that. I mean, I think that's why, I think really that's why. And I think that he is more mindful and aware of different things that are going on. And I do think that he cares about, you know, those things. But yeah, that's why I think that he is more like that than others.
I wanted to jump back in time a little bit to sort of, we touched on it a little bit earlier, but I'm always very interested in sort of this parent perspective in relationship to, you know, what their child is going through. And Pete mentioned it earlier about sort of him being, you know, sort of this not as well-known name, and, you know, mock drafts had had him in like the second round or late second round or maybe even going undrafted. But there was that confidence that he had. He's mentioned that, you know, he was going from city to city and workout to workout, and he thought that he was killing it. But then the outside perspective hasn't really caught up with that yet. And I'm wondering, as a parent who has sort of an inside look and an inside track on what's going on with him personally, but then also this connection to the outside world, how was that period for you in the lead up to the draft and then the aftermath to sort of see the reward and have him pick the, like, where he was?
Well, I mean, leading up to the draft, like his last year in college, you know, we kind of had a conversation at the beginning of the year, and, you know, he said, you know, if I can get a double-double, average a double-double, he said, I'm going to go into the draft. And I think we both felt like he could do it, honestly. And he pretty much did average a double-double, and he kept getting better throughout the year. And then, you know, as we had to make the decision, I think the thing that made it the easiest was that, you know, because he was redshirted his freshman year, he was going to get his degree at the end of that year. So in my mind, it was like, it's a win-win situation. You know, he could have went back for another year, but at the same time, like, in his mind, he was already there, you know? So when we were, you know, he entered the draft and we were looking at the mock drafts, and everybody would tell me, you know, you shouldn't pay attention to those because they're not right. So I always looked at him though.
of course I would. Yes. Too.
4:13 p.m. you know.
refresh.
Yes.
That's right. Did they change? And for the most part, they were right, because when it started, they had him like, in, you know, number 46, number 38. So yeah, they were way off. But But yeah, towards the end, you know, he was up there. He was like number 18, number 16. Drop back down. But in my heart, like, I knew he could go first round. So I mean, just leading up to that point. Now I've been talking, so I forgot what the question was, but
it's okay, keep going.
But yeah, so leading up to that point, you know, then it was the combine, and you know, yeah, he got quite a few workouts. I don't remember how many. I know it was in the teens. And, you know, after each workout, we'd talk, and he'd just say, yeah, you know, I talked to him. They liked me. He'd say, you know, I killed it. And he'd tell me who was there, and he'd be like, yeah, I did way better than them. So then, you know, after the combine, you know, he did come from Utah, and nobody did know his name. And then after the combine, they knew his name a little bit more. You know, now it's definitely different. I think way more people know his name now.
Yeah, oh, that's for sure. That's,
as time progresses, he becomes more known just because of what he does on the court. So,
well, and he's earning every bit of it, right? Like, none of it's been given to him. He's having to earn all of it. So it's funny that you bring up the combine and just kind of the perception of him. I've talked to a few people, because he's been, you know, we all talk in the media room before games, and sometimes there's scouts from other teams or scouts for, you know, different publications. And I always try to talk to those people as much as I can. And your son is always comes up because he's the big guy that everybody's kind of kicking themselves over, right? And, you know, a couple of people have said, you know, he was so good at the combine, it felt like a fluke. It felt like, like, where did this guy come from? You know, and it's funny that almost that it was almost such so good that it seemed fluky. And what I'm curious about, and what I'm sure Laker fans are curious about, is kind of, how did you hear about the Lakers' interest, and kind of when around the process was that?
You said, how did I hear about it?
Yeah, I mean, obviously from Kyle, right? But like, when did you guys start getting the idea that, hey, the Lakers really, really like him? Because he's somebody that I heard prior to the draft that the Lakers had really fallen in love with him. And I'm kind of curious what that was like on your end of things.
Yeah, I mean, I think it started with the workouts. you know. And then when they did the one-on-one interviews, because I know that, you know, the first time when he did the interview, he met Magic, and he couldn't stop talking about Magic, you know. And he's like, oh, you know, I love it out there, you know. He just loved everything about LA and the Lakers. And leading up and after the workout, leading up to the draft, there was a couple of teams that I would hear, like I kind of knew the Lakers wanted them, and I kind of knew the Spurs wanted them. But luckily, I guess, he got to go where he wanted to go, and they picked him first. So,
yeah, and we are very, very grateful for that. Karri, in the kind of last few months, you yourself have become a bit of a celebrity. You're someone. I was at Spectrum Sports, which is the local station that covers the Lakers, and you know, we were talking about you and how rad you are on Twitter, and you know, just how enthusiastic of a parent you are, and just how behind Kyle you are. And then that's been something that's come up in the media room a couple of times. And then I was in the locker room, and your name came up, and Kyle was like, man, she got to calm down on Twitter. is it something, have you guys talked a little bit about, you know, kind of the, your rising celebrity, if you will?
Oh, no.
He hasn't been like, mom, stop, please. You're embarrassing me.
No, but.
I get the feeling he wouldn't dare do that after talking to you.
Oh, yes, he would. Yes, he would.
Okay.
No, but on Twitter, it's funny because I'll have some followers, and they'll say, is he really your son? Like, they don't believe me, number one. And then, and then they'll say, well, how come he doesn't follow you? Which I have never even looked, so I don't know if he does or not. But I can tell you this, like, he's my Twitter police. So if I post anything that he doesn't want me to post or doesn't like or doesn't think it's good, you know, I'll get a text. I already know. Like, even if I know in my head, like, okay, maybe I shouldn't post this, but I'm going to anyways. Like, 30 minutes later, I get a text and it says, mom, take it down. I'm like, ugh. I used to argue with him and be like, Kyle, it's not even that bad. But I don't anymore. I just delete.
Oh, so you listen to him and take it down.
I do.
It's all right. It's probably for the best. Probably, you know, I think you've already seen, and it's funny because Kyle's one of the first guys to kind of step in and stand up. He's done this for Lonzo and done it for Luke, where kind of the media will blow things out of proportion a bit, and he'll be like, no, I stand by this guy, or no, you got to give Lonzo a bit more time. He's young, you know, and so, I think he's got a pretty good feel for how the media works. And, you know, I think that's something that he's somebody that I really see, especially it's hard when you're a rookie, but I'm already seeing signs of him being like a leader. Is that something that you've seen over the course of his childhood as a guy that's kind of emerged as like the leader of his group of friends or in sports teams, things like that?
Oh yeah. I mean, especially when he plays, you know, he's always the one that's, you know, come on guys, huddle up, let's get together, you know, and telling them stuff on the court. So, and yeah, even with his friends when he was younger, he's just always kind of like the take charge kind of guy. So yeah, I definitely see that in him.
Yeah, I think that's something that as he gets older and as he becomes a more of a grown man rather than a young one, you know, he's really gonna emerge in that respect. So he's been a delight to cover, and Karri, you have been a delight to talk to. Thank you so much for joining us.
No problem. Thank you for having me.
Thank you.
All right. Thanks, everyone. We hope you enjoyed that. You've been listening to Laker Film Room Podcast. We'll catch you next time.